let me get right into this. I appreciate your time. Of course, you're Robert Diab. You're an assistant professor at the law school for Thomas Rivers University in British
Thompson
Columbia.
Thomas Rivers, yeah.
Yes. Okay. The issue that I had, there's two main issues I want to get to, at least to the one. It has to do with the common legal presumption or argument that is used to justify, that government agents justify their actions by, and that is if somebody is physically in Canada, then the Canadian laws apply, and whatever police agency or court is in the area would have jurisdiction. Now, I've not been able to discuss, you know, get any kind of evidence to support that that argument or that claim is actually true. So would you have any evidence to show that just because I or somebody else was physically in Canada, that the laws of Canada would apply and that there would be jurisdiction over us?
That's an interesting question. I mean, we don't typically seek justification for it. I mean, it doesn't typically come up as an issue. I think that as far as I understand, it seems to be a basic premise of kind of the modern liberal state, that the state has sovereignty over its territory, which means that it has jurisdiction. It has kind of the authority to apply its laws to anyone within its jurisdiction. I mean, I think that's just what I assume. I'm just trying to imagine a case in which somebody would take issue with those assumptions. And one example that comes to mind would be in tax cases. I remember being in the courts on a number of occasions where a tax matter would come up. I mean, these were not cases I was involved in myself, but I would be in the courtroom when a tax matter would come up, and an individual taxpayer would stand up and say and take issue with the idea that the court has jurisdiction over them, or whether it would simply make an issue of whether the state has the jurisdiction to tax them. And so on, and those arguments did not tend to get very far. And so, so long as the person identified themselves as the taxpayer in question who hasn't paid their taxes, that was it. It would proceed from there. So, I'm not sure if that answers your question, but that's my reading of it.
Well, it's interesting that a lot of the words that you used is very common. That there, you called it an assumption. And then you said that people would make an issue of it and that those arguments would be rejected. Now, I've had a common, I've had a similar thing happen where I'm just asking a question of evidence like I'm doing to you right now. And bureaucrats will typically reframe my question of evidence into an argument so that they can say, I'm not going to argue with you or your argument is frivolous when I haven't presented an argument at all. I think you're right. It is an assumption. It's a it's a modern premise, although it probably goes back. It's probably not so modern. They've always thought that if you were in the realm, the king's laws applied, and things like that. It just doesn't really answer the question, though. It may not be something that comes up very often because usually there are attorneys involved, and attorneys are officers of the court. And they're not going to necessarily challenge the underlying presumption or premise that they're a job and the whole system rests on. So it's people like myself that are doing it. It doesn't really answer the question, what evidence would there be, if any, that would prove that just because I was physically in Canada, that Canadian laws would apply to me?
Well, again, I mean, I think it's an axiomatic assumption of contemporary law in the Western democracy that the state has sovereignty over its territory, and that one of the kind of incidents of sovereignty is that it may or it will apply its laws to everyone within its jurisdiction, and that everyone within the jurisdiction enjoys the benefits of those laws equally. So you can interrogate those assumptions by asking, well, when did I individually, Joe Citizen or a visitor, for example, when did I accede to those assumptions. I mean, you know, so for example, I was born in Canada, or if you were born in the United States, you might say, fine, you have this entity called the United States of America. It claims sovereignty over this territory. But I was born here, and I feel entitled to be here as anyone else, and I don't remember ever agreeing to be part of this. I think those are really important questions, and that the only answer to them is a kind of theoretical one, a notional one. And, you know, we can turn to Rousseau, we can turn to Hobbes, and we can Locke. We can try and construct a theory as to what's happening here. I mean, is it that in a sense, you know, I am impliedly consenting to be a part of the state on the idea that, you know, in return for security, I get the benefit of the law and so on. And that generally speaking, if I don't like this arrangement, I'm free to leave. Is that kind of the larger argument for this?
No, because
so long as I remain here, I have to abide by the laws. That would be my closest approximation, I think.
I think that particular approximation or that argument falls in the fact that everybody physically in Canada is forced to pay. You either pay or you go to jail. So
yeah.
The idea of implied consent, you would agree that it really isn't a implied consent, or any consent, when it's pay or go to jail.
Like you mean taxes?
Well, right. All support for the Canadian government is by taxation, and taxation is a political euphemism for pay or go to jail.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, you tell me. I mean, look, I mean, you're free to leave if you don't like it, but you sort of can't, you're not free to stay and opt out of it, is, I guess, your point.
Yeah, but free to leave is kind of, doesn't that sound more like you're blaming the victim and you're excusing the abhorrent behavior of the individual who's using the force?
I don't disagree, but what it comes back to is your initial question, which is a really good one. When did the state acquire the legitimacy, the authority by which it can, you know, put us in this situation where we have to choose either, you know, pay or leave, you know, or else you're going to go to jail? I mean, when did it acquire that authority? And I think the short answer is it never really did. It simply asserted that authority. This is simply how sovereignty developed, and we can attempt, you know, theoretical justifications of it, but they're notional, right? I mean, they're arguments, and maybe they don't ultimately stand up. You know, maybe you're not ultimately satisfied by the theory of implied consent. This is a live issue for Canadians because a number of Aboriginal peoples in Canada, especially in the western part of Canada, do not have treaties with the Crown. And so there was no point in time at which they agreed to cede sovereignty locally to the Crown. And the courts in Canada in the last 20 years, and especially in the last 5 or 10, have been increasingly sympathetic to the argument that, look, we never sort of came to an agreement with them, and so there's a lot of land in Canada, a lot of land in British Columbia, over which the claim to sovereignty is sort of unclear, and, you know, and without a sort of clear basis on which to say, you know, at this point in time, you give up your claim to this land, we can't really say that they no longer have a claim. And in the summer, or a little earlier, there was a case called Chilcotin where the Supreme Court of Canada recognized their sovereignty, their claim, their right to title over a very substantial area of land in British Columbia. It's in the kind of lower middle part of the province, and so I think these developments are a recognition in part of the fact that apart from the blunt assertion of sovereignty, there is really no kind of airtight argument or justification for why the state has jurisdiction over everyone.
But when you say state, you always refer to it as it or an entity. Isn't the state just nothing really more than a DBA for people? Just the government, what we call the government, is just people, right? People like yourself.
Well, you could say that, but I mean, one of the more interesting developments of modern law from roughly, you know, the 16th century onward is is the invention of the state as an entity apart from the people who run it or who populate it. That may be a fiction, but it's a pretty important fiction, and it has a certain momentum behind it now that would be difficult to undo. Much of the world now organizes itself along the lines of this fiction. So, you are entirely right, I think, to attack it or to question its veracity, its legitimacy, and so on. But it's a fact, I think, that it is a major organizing, concept or framework in contemporary society. And it isn't going to go away easily, if you know what I mean.
No, from what you're saying is that they just asserted it. And so what you're talking about is a group of men and women, well, at the time, mainly men, if not all men, they just asserted that they had somehow a different right than everybody else, that they could just assert that their rules apply to everybody in a certain physical area. I mean, that's what I'm getting from, I think we're on the same page there, that you just a group of men asserted that we are the government and everyone in this area will pay us or we will pay men to put them in jail. I mean, that sounds pretty accurate.
Yes, yeah, except I think that the idea of tax comes a little later. I mean, I think they assert the power and authority first for at least, two or three centuries, and then they begin taxing much later in time. But yes, I think you're right.
So this still begs the question, and maybe it's just more of a clarification from you. As far as being able to prove that just because I'm in, with evidence, just because I'm physically in Canada, to prove that these laws apply to me, how would, I don't, from what I'm getting from you, what you're saying, it's axiomatic, it's just a matter of opinion, it's a matter of just because we said so. Well, and it's based on, guys a couple hundred years ago asserted it. I mean, I had someone recently tell me it all goes back to, actually, I think it was one of your judges that said this, John Rook in the Meads case, that it all apparently goes back to William the Conqueror. I don't want to get too far off it. So let me just ask you, given that it's axiomatic and it's theoretical, wouldn't you agree then that you can't prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the laws apply to somebody just because they're physically in Canada?
I think you're confusing different notions. I mean, when you assert as a proposition, when you ask as a question, which you did at the beginning, do the laws of Canada apply to everyone within our territorial jurisdiction? I mean, as a practical matter, they do. I mean, I'm simply saying that if you come to Canada, you will find that the laws will apply to you. They will be applied as a practical matter. It's a separate question as to whether there is a justification for their application. If you sort of stand up in court when you're pulled over for speeding, say, and say to the judge, "Your Honor, prove to me that they ought to apply, they should apply, that they, they deserve to apply, and so forth." That's a different issue. I mean, the judge, and I agree with you. The judge will, you will stump the judge. The judge will say, "Well, I can't ultimately justify their application to you. That's not my job. My job is simply to apply them. I'm simply going to assume the authority to apply them, and I'm going to apply them, and if you don't like it, the sheriff is going to stand right behind you and, put you in handcuffs and take you downstairs. You see what I mean?"
Well, see, it's nice that you understand the practical application of this, but you got my question wrong. My question at the beginning, and it still is there any evidence to prove that just because I'm physically in Canada that your laws apply to me? And I think that you're absolutely right what you're saying about the judge. You are going to stump the judge. But who we're really looking to stump is the prosecutor, because the prosecutor bears the burden of proof because he's the one who filed the complaint. So, again, the question is there any evidence to prove that just because I'm physically in Canada, the laws apply?
Well, once again, the reason I don't think... I don't think that's a meaningful way of posing the question, is that evidence would be tendered in a court of law where it to support a a finding of fact that you want the court to make. So in other words, you want the court to find as a fact that John is guilty of speeding. You would not enter a court of law to debate the issue of whether the law applies to a certain, generally speaking. I mean, you might argue about whether a certain law applies to a person in a given situation, but as a general proposition, you wouldn't walk into court and say, and encounter a debate between the Crown and an accused as to whether the laws of Canada apply to someone. I mean, that would, once again, that would be axiomatic. That would not be something the Crown is called upon to prove as a matter of evidence.
Yeah, but you threw a word in there that is typical of, and I'm not saying you are, because we've been on for a while, and it's a pleasure to speak with you and explore these issues. But usually when the word debate is thrown in there, it's usually also put in with argue. And when someone asks a question of evidence, it's not an issue. It's not an invitation to debate. It's just the prosecution has the burden of proving. The one who makes the proponent of the argument always bears the burden of proof, and that's true even in the courts, as corrupt and as I believe, you know, Stephen, that they are. But even that holds. So my asking a question: what evidence do you have to support this legal claim? Whether we're in or out of court, the claim is made all day. So whether someone's in or out of court is completely irrelevant, really, to whether or not there is evidence to support the claim. And from what I'm getting from you, and you've said it a number of times, it's not a matter of evidence. It's a matter of theory, and that you're considering it axiomatic that we're taking it as true because other people have said so. I mean, would that be an accurate characterization?
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think Yeah, it's a starting point. You know, the laws apply, and the question is, you know, does this law apply to does the law that you cannot speed, does it apply in the case of this person? You know, has this person sped? That's what we want to have evidence about. But
you can't get in the door, sir. I mean, territorial jurisdiction, in or out of court. The jurisdiction being a threshold issue. Whether or not somebody violated the law is completely irrelevant until you first are able to prove that the laws apply. And so what I'm...
Right, and look, I agree with you, but what I'm trying to convey is the simple point that the question of whether the law applies to a person is not a matter on which the courts ask the Crown to establish evidence. It's not the starting point. There are a number of cases in Canada, and I'm sure there are thousands in the States, where people attempt to evade the jurisdiction of the court or the jurisdiction of the state. That's how they try to kind of start the case. And I think the courts in both countries and probably across the Western world are very clear that they simply won't entertain that kind of argument. They're always going to say, no, we start from the premise that our laws apply to everyone, and what's your answer to the claim that you've broken the law? That's the only question here.
Okay, so that begs the question. That begs the question. I'm sorry, that begs the question, though, being, and we've asked this of judges, and you're right, it tends to stump them, and they call security. The question being, do these laws apply to me because you said so, or because the prosecution's evidence proves it?
No, it's because we said so. No, it has that quality of just a mere assertion.
Because
there is something, you know, yeah, it's simply an assertion of power and authority. It isn't justified in a rational way, and it's certainly not. It's not justified by evidence. Neither argument nor evidence is made in this respect, any call for it will go unanswered.
That's true.
You'll just be told the starting point.
That's true. However, it really makes a mess of things on cross examination when, let's say, a tax agent for the CRA or a police officer has made that legal determination and is now on cross examination dealing with his competency and his credibility. And 100% of the time, you do that, you can get the Crown or the state prosecutor to actually impeach his own witness and say the witness isn't qualified. Now the judge is in a real bad spot. He just impeached his own, the only witness against you, that he's not qualified to give legal opinions, and yet the whole thing is based on a legal opinion that you violated the law. I'm glad that you did say it was irrational, and that's because we said so. Because that leads me into, because it's not an issue of evidence, whether you're in or out of court. It's just you have men and women asserting it, and it's nothing more than on, you know, under all that paperwork is a very real gun and a threat that if you don't do as we tell you, we will go through this thing called a prosecution and we will put you in jail. So my next question is to really strike at the root more at how the immoral, irrational basis of the system, government, not just Canada, all of them, is to ask you if I was to do things like the Canadian government, the men and women who are the Canadian government, and I was to force perfect strangers to give me money, would you consider me a criminal?
Well, that's right. That would be there would be something untoward about that. By the way, I don't know that it's immoral. I wasn't seeking to comment on the morality of it, but
okay.
But there's an obvious. It's obviously part and parcel of a larger colonial tradition or an imperialist tradition, obviously. But if you're looking at, for example, the United Kingdom alone, and you go back far enough into this history, it's not about imperialism. It's just about kind of the violence with which the state is always founded. So I'm not sure where morality fits in there, but you know, it's definitely a consideration.
Is it immoral for somebody to force a stranger to give the money?
It is. It is.
Okay.
And I agree. And there's a whole bunch of moral issues about peoples who have been disenfranchised by the creation of the state, Aboriginal peoples. There's issues with when a state erects borders and keeps people out, like immigration, similar issues with extradition when we're talking about states handing people over to face the death penalty outside of the country. These are all issues that call into question the morality of sovereignty. You're entirely right to be questioning it, and you're free to question it. That's also part of the modern state too. But I would bring it back. I would bring our conversation back to the question of what's the practical effect of it. I mean, by calling into question the legitimacy of the state's claim to jurisdiction, what can you really accomplish? That's my question.
Well, ultimately, in the long run, is to get to a voluntary stateless society where the concept of government is no longer accepted by enough people, that enough people will not participate and will not comply, they won't cooperate. I can't say, or comply. So that's what we're, part of what, mainly what I'm looking to do on the show. It also has been able to, on three continents, been able to, by striking at the root and showing the prosecution or the proponent of the argument, admittedly has no evidence because we said so, has gotten a lot of tickets and assessments thrown out and continues to do so on three continents, which is great. But I want to, the issue, now you agree that if I did it as an individual, it's immoral. Now, government being just men and women, isn't it just as immoral or as immoral for them to force perfect strangers to give them money?
Well, it can be. It can be.
It can be.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes, just in you know, among other ways, the ways we were talking about in terms of the Aboriginal crown dispute. I think there's a great deal of moral turpitude in that relationship.
So, are there examples where it would not be immoral to force a perfect stranger to give you money?
Well, I mean, in the sense that we spoke of earlier, where you find yourself a resident of a community and the community raises, for example, like the government of that community raises taxes, and you're confronted with a choice: do I want to continue paying into this scheme, or do I have to move? In that sense, you are you are obliged but not necessarily forced in the same way that you are when you're robbed, right? I mean, when you're robbed, a certain violence is going to be done to you. Whereas when taxes are raised in a certain area, you are free to leave. And you're also free to oppose and to protest and to be part of the government, right? I mean, you can go to City Hall and raise a stink and, you know, you're free to try and persuade a majority of your fellow community members that this is not a good idea. You know, we should not have high taxes and so on. So I don't know that the robbery analogy maps onto this perfectly.
Well, you keep saying leave. If we can establish that it's immoral for me to force a perfect stranger to give me money, how does that make it not immoral just because my victim can run away? How does that change the fundamental immoral act that I'm committing?
Well, because, I mean, with the analogy of being robbed is one in which, or at least the example is one in which, you have no, like, you and the robber have no connection, no relationship. Whereas when I'm a member of a community that's taxing me, the taxing authority isn't this absolute other, right? It's not this foreign entity, this enemy, right? It's me, it's my family, it's my community, right? It's my neighbor. It's the collection of neighbors.
I would say that that's wrong, because we've already come to agreement that the issue of implied consent is wrong, because everyone is forced to pay. Sure you would agree that the relationship.
Right. I mean, on that reading, once again, the state or the government is this illegitimate entity that is totally other than all the citizens that make up the state. I don't know, but I'm not sure I agree with that. I think there's other ways of reading what the state is or what the government is. Maybe a better analogy for it is it's the community deciding how it's going to govern itself, if that makes sense.
Well, it doesn't make sense because we know that everybody is forced to pay, and just because someone like yourself can get and be a part of the organization is really no different than in ancient Israel, where the local Jews were used as tax collectors for the Romans. Yeah, they were collecting the taxes, but you know it was still a grossly immoral, destructive, violent organization known as the Roman government. So it really, I don't think it makes, and it goes against the evidence to say that the people called government who are acting as government are actually agents of the people in doing what they want, because everyone is forced to pay. You either pay or you go to jail, or you're told, if you don't like the fact that I am forcing you to pay, you can always leave, which of course is another fallacy, because you can't just leave. You need permission to leave. You would never be able to cross without permission from the Canadian government into the United States government. And it's an old fallacy that really crops up to justify what I think we're in agreement in that it is immoral to force strangers to pay you, even if you live in the same community.
Is it theoretically legally possible in the United States to pass a constitutional amendment that says tomorrow, could this not happen in theory, a majority of the United, like whatever the amending formula is for the U.S. Constitution, but the point is it's going to take a very strong majority. But let's just say, hypothetically, 98% of the United States, of the population of the United States, decides tomorrow that we want to amend the Constitution to make taxation, to abolish taxation of any kind, okay? Can they do that? Yes, they can. That is a theoretical possibility, okay? So what that means is that taxation is not the result of a small minority of people in the United States, the government, placing an obligation on the rest of the people. Because the people collectively have this power to change the rules, to make up the rules as they go along, in theory, the rules as they stand are the collective expression of the will of the people. Is that not so?
No, I disagree, because everybody, like the implied consent argument, the facts are, and I don't think we can reasonably dispute these facts, that everybody pays, whether you go, the threat is you pay or you go to jail. It's in the CRA's own paperwork. You either.
Well, that's right. That's right. That's the law as we have it now, right? But is this law being imposed by this absolute other we call the government, this Martian entity that's coming along and saying to us strangers, the good citizens, you must pay or you will suffer violent consequences? Or is it really that, in theory, but also quite literally, notionally, we can tomorrow decide collectively whatever we want? We could tomorrow decide constitutionally, we could amend the U.S. Constitution to say, tomorrow the government will no longer resign, you know, it'll no longer be Congress in Washington. It will be something that meets once every 5 years. It'll have no taxing authority. I mean, it can be whatever it wants, right? I mean, is there not this freedom in the modern democracy?
Well, yes, you could do that. I think the more important thing that I look at is that once enough people don't buy into, and this will be another question for you, the double standard that is okay to lie, steal, kill, and cheat people just because you call yourself a government. And once people...
Right. So now,
let me finish.
We're talking about the oppression of the majority.
But it all comes from that, because the people accept a double standard that is okay to force other people to give the money if you call yourself a government. All the other abuse stems directly from that. And so the people, when enough people, which is why I do this show, not to go through the political process, but to get enough people to understand that these people who are called government are only government because they said so. They only have authority because they say so. They only have all these things because they say so. They're no more legitimate than a mafia or La Cosa Nostra.
Now you're making a different point. So now your point is that the government doesn't have a true mandate, is I guess the point you're now making. So it's a different point from the one we were chatting about just a minute ago. So, but can't you disprove that or address that by showing, look, a majority of American citizens, like, I don't know, a significant majority, like, if 70% of the voting public in the United States voted for the government, does that not address your concern?
No, because the only concern that is important is that the foundation forcing other people to pay you is wrong. It's always wrong. And that's why I asked you, can there be an exception to that? And you didn't answer it directly. You initially said it can be.
Right. Okay. So now this is a different argument still. So in other words, if in a community of 20 people, 15 of them decide that everybody should pay tax, what you're suggesting is that it's illegitimate if one of the remaining five who didn't think taxation was a good idea, if they have to pay tax against their will. Is there not something untoward about that?
No, I think you're mischaracterizing it. I think what you're asking, with a more accurate way to put that, is we all agree that it is immoral and wrong to force somebody to give you money. What you're trying to say is if 15 people get together, they can violate that moral law because they have numbers. And I disagree with that completely, because that's the same as saying, well, we've got 15, you only got 3, and we're saying rape is moral. I think what you're saying is that it's okay to force other people to give you money if you have a majority who agree to disregard the moral code of do no harm, or that it's wrong to, you know, force people to pay.
Well, I would say that you're skipping a step,
okay.
The first step that we can't overlook is that those 20 people began by saying, let's have a government. Like, let's not just be 20 people who happen to be living in a certain area. Let's have a government, and let's choose our own government. Let's not be governed by someone outside. Let's not have a king. Let's not have sort of one family that passes government down within itself. Let's elect every certain on a term basis. Let's choose among ourselves a leader. So one of the 20 people, or or a group of them is made the government, and that government is in theory acting on behalf of all 20, and that government decides we're going to have taxation, and may even put to a referendum, what do you think, all 20, should we have? Should we have taxation? So 15 of them agree we should have taxation. So 5 disagreed. So 5 are now in a conundrum. They can leave the community, or if they remain, the reason that they're going to be paying tax is not because they want to, yes, in the sense they're being forced to, but because they want to be a part of that community and they want to abide by the democratic system that's been chosen by that community as a way to govern itself. Now, is that not a fair way of describing what's going on in your local area?
No, it's not fair at all. There's no evidence. It's not true historically for the United States. It's certainly not true for the UK or Canada. You're talking about something that has absolutely never happened, where an entire community agreed to force themselves to pay each other. It on the other side of it, though, if that's not what you're saying, community.
Back up a bit. But no, I mean, think about the foundation of the United States. Okay, as a sovereign nation. The tax story is central to it, right? I mean, it was being overtaxed by Britain. It didn't like that idea, and so it revolted, and it said, we're going to be a separate country. We're going to be a country consisting of these states.
That's the narrative, sir.
Did that not happen?
No, that's the narrative, but what actually drove the revolution was Western expansion. George had cut the Western expansion. So if you look at
we're not there yet. How did we create our state, though?
But what if you're looking at the American example, you're talking about people who, just like you said in Canada, declared it, and they said anybody who's non-fighting for us. They passed their own navigation acts, and they started confiscating property and putting people like the Quakers and all the pacifists in jail and confiscating all their stuff. The American government is certainly not a beacon of moral authority, and it would really not be a good road to go down if you want to discuss a moral issue, you know, moral line with government, because the United States government historically knew that was a war of Western expansion. It was not, that was the narrative that they gave to get people to, hey, we got no taxation without reparations. It was Western expansion. So the U.S. government, especially after what they did after 1778 and 1777, is not an example historically. They committed genocide against the American Indians. They plotted to completely destroy them, and that's why they almost completely annihilated their food supply of the buffalo. So it really is getting away, I think, from the issue, because the other thing that I think you may have been saying, though, is that you're talking about 20 people agreeing to do something, and if they are agreeing to that, then they're not forcing each other to do something, and you're getting away from the whole moral issue or the facts of why government is immoral in the first place, and that is because everyone is forced to pay. There's the threat behind it. You're giving an example where there is no threat and not necessarily any coercion and jail time, and so I don't think that's an accurate analogy.
But, I mean, I think you've got to distinguish between the formation of a government and its decision to tax people. They don't necessarily go together. I think really the issue is when people disagree with being taxed or don't want to be taxed. Whether that's one issue and the question of their relationship to the government ought to be seen as a second issue. So I'm not sure. I mean, I think we're apart on this reading, but I do think it's worth distinguishing those two issues.
I understand that. It still comes down to a ruling class where you have someone telling a stranger, do this or you'll be punished. So even if you don't take taxation into the equation when you're talking about government, just because it's just men and women, and they are forcing you to pay them. And if we take that out, you're still having one person threatening another person that they should or should not do something. And unless that is, hey, you shouldn't aggress against me, unless the rule is do no harm, otherwise if you attack me, I will do what I need to do to defend myself. But that's not what government is talking about. They're talking about, you do as I say, or I will punish you severely. and I got these jails over here to do that. And so that's how governments are formed. That's how states or whatever, that's how people called government or called the state do it. You do as we say, and I'll quote you, because we said so. And that you,
right.
Okay, not because there's any moral authority behind it, not because there's any rationality, because you even said it's not rational. It's because there are a bunch of individual men and women who are acting in an immoral way. And the only reason why people accept them is because they don't apply the same moral standard to people called government that they do to themselves and to their neighbor. Because if you did extend the same moral code that applies to the mundanes like me, there's no way in the world you can make a moral argument for what people called government do.
Well, just to clarify, I do think there's. I mean, I've tried to offer a few arguments to describe or even justify what government does, but I'm not saying that they're absolutely correct. They're simply theories offered to justify it. The other thing is, I agree that when the government asserts jurisdiction, for example, through the courts in a legal case, it simply starts from the position that it has jurisdiction. It's a blunt assertion of that.
Yeah.
And it's irrational in the sense that it's not rationalized. It's just an assertion of power and authority. Whether it lacks all rationality is a different issue. Again, I think that there are theories to justify it, and I would question whether the citizen who is compelled to pay taxes against his or her will is a victim in the same sense that a robbery victim is a victim. The person in that situation is completely apart from the robber or from the criminal. The taxpayer, the compelled taxpayer, is also a member of a democracy with rights to vote, rights to protest, rights to organize, rights to change, not rights, but the ability, in theory, to work together with others to gain a majority, to change the Constitution, to change the law. So, they would have to do that, and they may not succeed, and in that case, you could say that they're always being coerced by the will of the majority. I think really that's the crux of your issue. I think your issue is what are a minority's rights in a constitutional democracy? And when you do have a minority, in what sense, to what extent can you really justify the coercive nature of the majority's will over the minority? I think that's really what we're talking about.
No. No,
but I mean that's my reading. I'm not okay. Saying you're wrong and I'm right, but I'm just saying that's how I read this set of facts.
Is it moral to force people to pay you if you claim to have a majority opinion that it's right?
Yes, I mean that's your question. I think that's the question. And I've offered one theory by which it can be moral. The democracy theory that you're free to try to persuade your fellow community members, which you're doing, right? You are doing this. You're free to try to persuade them, and I would think that ultimately, in theory, your ultimate goal here is, if enough people agreed with you, you could change the political constitution of the United States to allow for a much more a much less coercive form of government. And And I think it's important to realize that you have that freedom, that that's also, baked into the system in an important way. But, Mark, I need to stop you. I need to run very soon and take the kids to school. And it's parent-teacher day today, and so there's a whole bunch of things.
I understand, and we've gone way over what I had originally said, and I do appreciate that. Can I ask, just at one point maybe to ponder, is that given what you're saying, that the judges just assume it's true, the judges are supposed to also be obligated to presume your innocence and not to assume something. So how do you square that? How do you square that, the presumption of innocence, with the assumption of a major part of the prosecutor's case?
Well, I think the simple answer is that it's not considered a part of the prosecutor's case. The prosecution has only to prove the elements of the offense. And jurisdiction is an element. So, you know, identity, jurisdiction, and the actual particular elements of the offense, like, for example, theft, you know, the mens rea and the actus reus of the offense. Jurisdiction is proved by merely establishing that you committed the offense in this jurisdiction, in this place. It is not an element of the offense. It is not something the Crown has to prove to establish that this court, this government, this state has the authority to prosecute you. Once again, that's actually...
How do you prove that a law was violated without first proving that it applies in the first place?
You don't. It's not...
You don't.
I'm speaking practically. In practical terms, it is not something we are in the practice of assuming we must prove.
I understand.
Philosophical matter, it's a good question. And I began by agreeing with you on that.
Oh, yeah. No, you've been very gracious with your time. I appreciate it. It's gone way over again what we... It's been a pleasure to talk with you. If we're able to do this again, I would really appreciate it. But I do appreciate your time, sir.
It was a lot of fun chatting with you.
Yes, thank you very much. Have a good day.
Okay, thank you.